Hi everybody, this is the video for Lab 3, Geologic Maps, and what I'd like you to do is take out the map that you see on the PowerPoint slide here from your map roll. It's the colorful one, obviously. So this is the geologic map for the Masonville Quadrangle. Now, during the last couple of labs, you looked at the topographic map for the Masonville area, and that's the base for the geologic map that we have here. So you're gonna see some similarities to topographic maps and a few big differences. The most obvious difference are all the colors that you see on the map. Those colors refer to the various rocks that are exposed on the surface at each place on the map. So let's say you're in this area right here. You can see it's that sort of light pink rock. And if you look at the rock key, which is over here on the right, you can scroll down and find the rocks that are exposed in that area. And you'll see that it is this rock right here, the Fountain Formation. So anywhere in this area that you're walking, you will be walking on the Fountain Formation. Anywhere that you are walking on this, say this light blue right here, you're on this unit right here. And then underneath those names of the rocks are descriptions of the rock type, whether it's a sandstone or a shale, limestone, igneous rock. The other thing about these maps is that the answer key over here is a range in rock type from youngest at the top to oldest at the bottom. So in geology, the youngest rocks tend to be on top of older rocks. So this answer key sort of fits what you would see out in the real world. You'd see the younger rocks, the rocks up here towards the top of any stack of rocks, and then the older rocks on the bottom. But it depends on where you are. Now, the other thing you'll see is that underneath all of these colors is just a straight up topographic map. You will see topographic lines. You can see the name up here. Let's move forward. Along the edge of the map, you will see the same sorts of information that you have on your topographic map. You'll see the names of adjacent maps. So this is on the top of your map. The map that fits directly north of this map is Horsetooth Reservoir. It has township and range information along the edge, just like a regular topographic map. You will see section numbers within the squares down here. I don't have a good one right here, but I'll probably pull one up in a minute. And it shows distances to towns along roads, as well as some longitude and latitude information. So the base of this map is just a straight up topographic map. You can see all the different topographic lines right here. Right here, you see an intermittent stream, the dot and dash stream. Notice how the V's and the contour lines point uphill. So this stream would be flowing in that direction right there. So you have a lot of information on the map. You have topographic lines, you have section and township information, you have information about the rocks. So the rocks are designated not only by color, like right here, but also with a symbol that corresponds to the name and the age of the rock. So here's a closer look at the key for the rock types. Remember, the youngest rocks are up on top, the oldest rocks are down on bottom. Over here, it tells you the general eras that the rocks formed in. You'll see Cretaceous and Permian, Precambrian, things like that. And then here are the rock types here with the little descriptor there, and then it usually gives you some sort of description of the rocks that are there too. Now in class, we haven't talked much about rock types, and we'll get into that when we talk about groundwater, but I'll just give you a little introduction today. You're gonna be asked a couple questions about what kind of rock would make a good aquifer. An aquifer is a rock that easily transmits groundwater so that we can extract it from wells. So a good aquifer includes rocks such as sandstones, limestones, Those are the two best rocks for an aquifer. Now, rocks that make terrible aquifers are shales. So if you read these descriptions, you're going to find some rocks that have sandstones and limestones. Those would be good aquifers. And then you'll find others that will be shales. They're going to be terrible aquifers. And it's going to talk about if you drill down from the surface, which rock would you encounter first that would make the best aquifer? So you have to see which rock is on the surface. If this rock is on the surface, then as you drill down, all of these rocks below are going to be underneath. If this rock up here is on the surface, then all of these rocks will be underneath. It just depends on where you are as to what rocks lie beneath you. But the older rocks will always lie beneath you. So you can simply read the descriptions, see what kind of rocks are there, and then determine whether the rocks underneath would provide good areas to drill into for groundwater. So let's move forward. One of the other most important bits of information that you will find on your map. So I think this photo comes from kind of the northwest part of the map. You'll have to look around and take a look at what's going on. The symbols I want to draw your attention to are right here. The 16, the 17, those are called strike and dip symbols. And what they do is tell you how the rocks are oriented. And that sounds kind of weird, but most of the time in geology, rocks stack upon one another in a nice flat sort of layer cake way. They don't tilt one direction or the other. But give the earth enough time and tectonics to do their work, and those flat-lying rocks may start to tip one direction or another. These symbols refer to the direction that they're dipping. In these cases, you can see they're sort of pointed to the right or pointed to the east. That means that the rocks will dip down as you go from west to east into the ground. So they're going to plunge into the ground. Okay, and the 16 and 17 refers to the angle. Zero is flat, 90 is this, they're tipped up on their ends. So 17 is kind of a fairly shallow dip, okay? So we're going to use that information to tell us about how the rocks are oriented beneath the surface. Now over here on the left, you'll see some similar symbols. They're not exactly the same. The strike and dip has a long line with a little short line with a number. That refers to the dip direction. These over here have a line and a little triangle on it. We're not going to use these in this class very much. It refers to the foliation or the arrangement of grains within the rock and not the orientation of the rock itself. So when you see this symbol with the little triangle on it, just ignore it for this class. That's something that a more advanced geology student would be interested in. So the strike and dip symbols, though, are really important. And what they do is they give you some indication about what the rocks look like beneath the surface. The geologic map tells you what rocks are on the surface, and these symbols right here tell you what's going on beneath the symbols. And I will show you that in these next slides. So up in the upper right corner, you're going to notice a line going across your map. And it has an A on one side. If you follow it up, you're going to see A prime along the top of your map. That's called a cross-section line. And if you look at the bottom of your map, which I'm going to show you in a slide in a minute, it shows you what the rocks look like beneath the surface. So over here on the left at A, if you were there, you would see this sort of brownish depicted rock. You can look at your key and you're going to see that that's really old Precambrian rock, granites and gneisses and metamorphic rocks, really wild things. And then sitting on top of it, progressively younger rocks are sedimentary. You'll see sandstones and limestones and shales. So what you also notice are some strike and dip numbers. So there's a 15 degree to the east, there's a 15 degree to the east, there's a 13 degree to the east, there's a 17 degree to the east, and so on. So that tells you that the rocks are tipping downward to the east. And if you look at the very bottom of your map, you can see a cross section or a depiction of what the rocks look like beneath the surface from A to A prime. There's the A prime in the upper right corner. So as you go from A to A prime, you'll see all the rocks, the direction they're dipping, and what geologists can do is use that information to develop cross sections. We do this in geology, they do it in the oil industry, they do it for groundwater. It shows you where various rocks are located beneath the surface. So down here in the lower part of the map is the cross section from A to A prime. And you can see that the rocks are dipping down to the east at somewhere between a 15 and 20 degree angle. The other thing over here is it shows you the number of feet at the surface, or I guess that's up around 6,000 feet. And it drops a little down in the mid 5,000 and up to 6,500 over here by Milner Mountain and so on. So it shows you the lay of the land, the topography up here along the surface, and then it shows you how the rocks are dipping beneath the surface. And over here are some scale numbers as to how what the elevation of each of those are. But let's say you're over here on the right, standing on JM. And if you wanted to drill down to the Precambrian rock right here, you'd have to go all the way down to here. And you can look along the edge, and it looks like you're starting about 5,500 feet, and you end up down here around 3,000 feet. So that's about 2,500 feet in drilling, or roughly half a mile. So I've got some questions about how far down you have to drill at various points to intersect different rock units. And you can find a lot of that in these cross sections along the bottom. Like I said before, your geologic map has a scale, just like a topographic map. It tells you the contour interval of the contour lines. This is a 1 to 24,000 scale map, so any unit on the map equals 24,000 of the same units in real life. So if you measure from here to here on your map and it's 2 centimeters, in real life, it's going to be 24,000 times more than that, or 48,000 centimeters. If you measured something that was, say, an inch over here, it would be 24,000 inches in real life. If it was 3 inches, it'd be 24,000 times 3, or I guess that's 72,000 inches. So get used to using those scales. Over here you've got true north, magnetic north. Over here it shows you in general where the map is located. You can see where adjacent maps fit along your map. So there's lots of information on these things. So hopefully that gives you enough information to get going on this assignment. You'll have some questions. Email me. I'm going to give you 2 weeks to do this. So this should be due 2 weeks from today. And again, if you have questions, simply email them to me and I'll try to get back to you. If you're doing face-to-face, we can talk about this in class. If you're struggling with this, and this will be more difficult than the topographic map. So if you have some issues and you're doing this course online, we can always set up a little Zoom meeting and it'll be a little easier for me to show you things. There's a fair bit of information I haven't talked about yet. I'm just gonna let you get started and try to figure it out for yourself, a little self-learning. But when you run into roadblocks, send me an email, set up a Zoom meeting, show up in class, whatever it takes, okay? So I'm going to give you a couple weeks to do this, and then the next lab will be review of the topographic maps and the geologic maps. I want to give you guys a month or two to really get used to reading these things. So again, if you have questions, let me know, and I hope you do well.